Hi, this is Steve Hopkins, and this is Pong Now, an interview series talking table tennis with some of the best players and personalities in the sport. Today with me, I have Dan Seemiller, and man, I have a long list of stuff that I could read through, but just going super short, I think this is your 25th year as head coach at South Bend Table Tennis Club. You were a former USATT president. Five-time U.S. singles champion, Hall of Fame member, former baseball player drafted by the Pirates, and current events, also an author. How you doing, Dan?
Doing great. Still very involved in table tennis. I have my book coming out called Smash, and I'm really excited about that. Matter of fact, I just got a shipment yesterday and sent a bunch out, so so excited about that, and I always seem to have a project coming up sooner or later.
So why don't we work through some of this stuff backwards? Let's start with the book. So how many books have you written now?
Three. All right. I have my how-to book, Winning Table Tennis, and then my autobiography, Revelations of Table Tennis, of a Ping Pong Champion, and then Smash, Moments, Mysteries, Moments and Tips, Memories and Tips.
All right. So what led you towards writing this particular one, and why now?
Well, I always felt my autobiography didn't go over real well. I mean, it's a good story, but it's a little boring to hear someone's life story. And then I have all these amazing photos that when I was, during the pandemic, every day in the morning, I'd go down and look at all these photos and I'd say, oh, this could be a good story. And this could be, oh, I like this one. And I'd go up in the morning and I'd post it on Facebook and I'd get 200 or 300 likes. And I think, man, I'd do it every morning for like 300 mornings in a row. And then I thought, hey, I could probably put this into a book because it seems like everybody likes it. So my book is basically a picture, and then I give maybe a paragraph or two of the story. And then we move on to the next page and it's completely random. So you could go from the nationals to the worlds to a big problem. I hope it sells well because I think it stands good for table tennis, and I know I'm biased, but it's good.
All right. So how about a teaser? Let's ask a leading question. Give me like your biggest highlight as a player.
Biggest highlight as a player is probably two, but I'll take the 1982 Nationals when Eric Bogan had me 1-0 2014. And I came back and won that game. And then we got to the fifth game and he was 19-16 up and serving, and I got all five. And that was my fourth national championship. And I'll tell you, he was probably a better player than me, but I grinded that one out. And nothing feels better when you kind of get a win that maybe you kind of stole.
And did someone capture that moment perfectly with a photo? Is that memory in the book?
That memory is right in the book. I have some photos of me and Eric that are absolutely on the moment amazing, that certainly for me, but there are some in there that are so dramatic that I think it'll make the book really good.
All right. So again, kind of working backwards through things. Give me a biggest moment as a coach.
Biggest moment as a coach is going to Athens, Greece with the Olympic team. I was the coach and Mark Kaczynski made the team, and I started coaching Mark when he was 11. So Mark was at that time, I think, 18. And here we were, there was just three men on the team and one coach. And here we were going to the Olympics together. So that one probably is the big one.
I think I've seen photos of you guys playing doubles together and hugging after matches and stuff too. You staying in contact with Mark?
It's been a while. He's down in Dallas and he's running a couple of businesses and he's coaching. So he's really full of a lot of work. But I'll tell you, there's a lot about Mark in the book and I think he'll like it.
All right. So as I said, if I'm doing the math correctly, this is your 25th year in South Bend. How did that come about?
Well, I guess, I was about 42 years old and, hard to make a living in Pittsburgh, hard to make a living in table tennis at that point. And then I had given that Victor Tolkachev was a coach over there and he had to go back to Latvia. And we were looking for a coach. I was the president at the time. And we couldn't find a coach. And then finally, Brad Ballmer said, well, what about you? And I said, oh, no. I have all my family. I can't leave Pittsburgh. But then I thought about the financials and where I was at that age of 42. And if I could go to South Bend, they have a nice program there. It's a nice small city. And I could go home after work. I had never gone home after work. I was always somewhere else. And my kids were young. So I thought, talk to my wife. I said, boy, they got 20 kids there. They got a good program. And I could go home after work and we'll have some steady pay. And 25 years later, I didn't think we'd ever make it past 3 or 4 years for a club to pay rent and my salary and all the expenses. But we've been blessed that people stepped up when we needed them.
And you can't be too modest about the success that's come out of there either. Name drop a little. Name some of the players that you've coached and been around while you were there.
Well, Joey Cochran, he was an awesome player. He won, I think, the under 21 like 4 years in a row. Mark Kaczynski won the under 21 5 years in a row. I think my greatest accomplishment as a coach was in 2007. We went to the trials in San Diego, and Mark Kaczynski won the men's trials. Joey Cochran won the junior trials, and A.J. Brewer came in second in the cadet trial. So we almost did a full sweep from a little town in South Bend at the trials that year. The only problem with that was I thought, how are we ever going to top this?
So going back a lot of years, I was sitting with you on some bleachers, and I think it was Grand Rapids, but I don't remember exactly, you know, which event we were at. And I asked you a question about your grip and how it would fare with the new ball and some of those things. I'm going to ask again today because I'm a little curious. So 25 years in South Bend, all of those guys came out of there playing standard. They're using both sides of the paddle. I don't see a lot of anti guys, that have made it up. If you were doing it all again, would you be playing with a standard grip or would you be playing one-sided the way that you did?
I would definitely play one-sided. I always like to be unique. I like to travel. You know, if everyone goes right, I want to go left. We'll meet you up there. If 10,000 people are going left, I'd rather go right where there's only 100. And it's a sport, especially if you're playing international, being unique is a big benefit. And that's why my international results are so good. Same with Bogan and Brian Masters and Ricky. You go internationally, you're playing unique. They don't know how to play you. So there are some technical difficulties with it, but I still think even now the game is so complex that someone that takes this, I have Deon Payne Miller who plays now, and he's about 2,300. And he says he wants to go full time. He says, Coach, I want to see what a 2,600, 2,700 Seemiller player looks like. And so would I. I really would. I think that it really is. If you're a great athlete and you take this under your wing, you could maybe go all the way to the top.
Well, that was kind of my question. When I watch the video of you guys playing and when I think through it the way that I used to watch it when I was little, it was very fast, over the table, still not flat, still, heavy topspin, even over the table. And it has always seemed to me that if you were playing with the bigger ball, you were playing with the speeds of today, that you would still have crazy angles. You would still push people away from the table. It seems like there would be lots of advantages there. When you watch top level play, where do you think a Seemiller grip 2,700 player would fit in? What would a match look like?
Well, definitely have a dynamic third ball attack for sure. Got to have that. Great mixture every once in a while with the anti-spin to break up the depth of the ball and get the player to move in and out a little bit. And probably have the one big problem with our style is the counter loop. We get kind of stuck in our backhand and we're a little late on the forehand. So that probably has to be fixed and maybe it's just a quicker athlete and looking for it. Right now, blocking, you can win blocking now. Before with the other balls, it was too spinny. You just got spun off the table. Now you can block that ball so quick and so hard with great angles that, I think it's now a style that is somewhat acceptable. Whereas before, if you block, they're going to say, well, you can't win that way.
Well, maybe, maybe you'll be expanding your training program a little bit, and we'll get three or four top Seemiller players out of there, and American grip will be a thing again, in the international realm.
I actually have all my students now are all playing Seemiller style.
Okay.
And they're all getting really good. I have one that's he was playing Seemiller style, and he was maybe my best prospect, and he switched over, and it hurt me. Because I really think he's like a mini me. He's lefty with a great forehand, a good backhand, and he had great results. And he just said he wanted to go to a normal backhand, which is a kind of funny thing, but that's okay. You know, you always want players to be happy. That's the main thing.
All right. So I live in New England, and we have Tom Brady, we had Tom Brady until last year. And for about 5 years, every time anybody got him on a radio show, they had a GOAT conversation about, you're the greatest of all time, and how do you compare with everybody else? And I'm not going to put you in that position, but let's play this Mount Rushmore game. If we expand Mount Rushmore to five names, and I put you there ahead of time, what do you think the right discussion would be for putting another four faces up on that American table tennis mountain? Are the better players after you, or the better players before you? Is there a mix of that? Who do you think got the game to where the game is today?
Well, that's a tough question, but I mean, there's a lot of guys that would certainly be in there. You know, Connect Jaw is on his way up. He's maybe going to be the greatest American player ever. Who knows? We've got a lot of hope with him. You know, Sean O'Neill, of course. Eric Bogan was maybe internationally the greatest American player ever. Jimmy Butler, for a while, was just amazing in 1992 and 90. He was really right in there. So those four guys for sure. Before that, you know, in the old days, I always admired Irwin Klein. You know, they always called him the natural, and certainly Marty Riesman and those guys from the old days. And of course, my brother Rick, you know, doesn't get all the acclaim, but you know, we won eight doubles together. He was on this team many times. He beat Applegreen at the Worlds, he beat Orlowski at the Worlds. Being the second brother, a lot of times he just got pooed off to the side, but Ricky was right in there with all of them.
Who was your biggest rival early on in your career? Who did you have to jump over to get to the top?
First one was Dal Jun Lee. You know, he was six times U.S. champion, and right, that's when I came up. And then John Tannehill was right behind him, and he was tough as nails. So I had to get over Lee, and actually Lee wasn't that tough because he was getting older, but Tannehill was in his prime, and I jumped right over him. And I never thought that was possible. I mean, I thought John was the greatest player I ever saw. He hit the corners, he hit the edges, he never missed a shot, but he was a little bit soft. And I found that out. And with my anti-spin, and I was able to beat him in the Canadian Open, and I beat him in the team trials. And then next day I knew I was number one. I jumped right over all those guys.
And let's jump to the end of your career. All right. So I won't say end of your career. We're all still playing, right? So towards the end of your run as being number one, who were you beating off? Who were you fighting to stay above?
Well, it was always me and Eric for sure. But then Sean came in, and Sean took me out. You know, he got me at the several nationals in a row. In the beginning, it was very close. Could have gone either way. But then by the third or fourth year, you know, he had, you know, young and really fast, and he knew how to play me. I had trouble with Sean for sure. I definitely had trouble with Jimmy Butler, too. I mean, his serves just ate me alive. So those two guys. And then, of course, Bogan and I, you know, we were like heavyweights. We were like Ali Frazier. I mean, literally, when we went to the court, literally, it was like the most important thing that could ever happen. And then in the end, it usually was.
So you're a really competitive guy on the court. Were you two guys friends off of the court?
Eric and I were friends off the court, but not really socially. We never had any. I don't think Eric and I ever really had a problem on the court. I mean, he always stalled a little bit and I yelled a lot. So we each had our own little idiosyncrasies. He didn't like me yelling, and I didn't like him stalling. So, you know, we were even. But I remember my brother Ricky, he used to say, Eric Stalling's ticking me off. He's just ticking me off. I said, you know he's going to stall. Don't worry about it. Just stay and wait until he's ready to serve and then go. That'll tick him off. So when guys play mind games with you, you have to be ready for that, because if you're not ready to play it back, you'll get played.
All right. So how about modern game, modern players? Who do you like to watch out there internationally right now?
Certainly Canuck. Love watching Canuck. Colorado's exciting for sure. I don't like watching Ovcharov, but I like watching the other guy, so I hope the other guy beats him. I don't know why. those are sort of my favorites. I don't like watching Hanamoto because he screams all the time, drives me nuts. Can't stand that, so I can't even watch that. But those are Korean players are great to watch too. I love to watch their footwork and how dedicated they are.
All right. So I'm going to turn this just a little bit towards developmental table tennis and where we ought to be in the future. And then we'll kind of be done there, and we can have another conversation another time. But you've been a coach and you've been, developed a club. You also had a time as USATT president. Do you have any advice or suggestions for what the game should be doing to better develop and where we should be headed as a sport?
Funny you should ask. there's real problems with USA table tennis. I really think so. With the Olympic thing, it takes up all the time and the members get kind of lost. That's one thing that I think really needs to change. You know, back when I was president, we had 9 people on the board and we all had a vision and we were all involved in the sport and we all had some visions for the sport and where we should go. And now it seems like with the Olympic people on the board, it seems like everybody's just dotting the I and crossing the T's and making sure everything is legal. And there is no real vision. My main thing is you have to have prize money. You have to keep growing your prize money. In the nationals, there's no excuse for it to be $5,000. It should be $20,000, $25,000. We have the money. Just earmark it for that. So that's so important. And if you don't have prize money, you're going to be a small sport forever. That's respect. And one thing about prize money, and you can quote me on this, it's always earned. Prize money is always earned. So you never give it to someone. You never give it to a project. That person earns it. And when they earn it, what do? They use it to get better. And the guys below it, they look up and say, I want that money so I can train too. So I think that to me, that's really the number one goal of everything. And with the Olympic Committee, it's not even on the board with anyone. And when I see that, I get really sad, because I'd like to see tournaments and the USATT working with tournament directors like I did when I was president and helping them along, find sponsors, give them money, help them get their prize money up to where it's really respectable and keep it growing. Don't go backwards. Keep going backwards. We had $5,000 for the winner in 1977. So that's what I would say. We are doing a lot of good things with the kids. I'll say that. And the USATT is doing the best they can. But there's sort of there's a break there that the members, not really being taken care of. It's all kind of only the elites and the Olympics and getting the players ready and spending all the money there. And members, well, you can come along for the ride. Before, the members were the crucial thing. They were number one. And now you can tell it's been a little bit behind. I don't blame the CEO or anything like that. Their work is very hard. But I think somehow the board has to get more vision.
Yeah. Do you see any potential solution for that? Always all of the arguments are, money solves everything. But for all of the time that I've been involved in the sport, I've never seen, masses of corporate sponsors jumping in to support the sport. I've heard some folks talk about splitting the organization. So there's one that focuses on members and one that focuses, on the Olympic side of things. I've seen clubs that have tried to kind of split off and do their own thing. I've seen, all sorts of other possibilities and other ways of going about it, but we do always seem to kind of come back to the same place. We've got lots of kind of independent groups, lots of members at these clubs that aren't really USATT members. At least this year, they're kind of reaching out to those folks and trying to come up with a very inexpensive way for people to stick around and become USATT members. But I've never really been able to see what a solution was. And I don't think there's been an obvious one, or smart guys like you, you know, would have made that obvious to everybody and they would have been headed in that direction. Do you have a suggestion as to how to address these things and get to a point where we have a board with the right focus for all of these different kind of competing constituencies?
Well, you know, it's been going on forever, so I don't know, but what, I don't think you could start a new association, because that would be far, it would take too long. But I think the USATT itself could break into two pieces. And I think everyone would love that. And then you would have the CEO and someone handling the elite and the Olympic, and someone totally in charge of membership, services, tournaments, nationals, pride, you know, other things too. And then hopefully those two would come together. Right now, one's doing it all. And the bottom piece gets totally lost. But I think you could almost have two CEOs within this, or maybe an assistant CEO who would take care of making sure the Nationals made money, making sure the Open made money, make sure that, you know, all the details were taken care of, that when we go to the Nationals, that the time schedule works. You know, that someone who, like, I would say like me, or someone who has actual experience can make sure that these things don't happen. And usually it happens and they'll say, oh, we're real sorry. You know, we'll do better next time. They'll forget that. We've heard that 100 times and it keeps on happening. I mean, honestly, I would almost want to be CEO of table tennis, but I don't have the background. But if I had a good right-hand man, I think I could almost do it and I could take us to a heights. It would be unbelievable. But right now I'm too old and that's just a dream. And I wish those that are in there, they can do the best they can. But I just know that we need someone with more experience and more vision. And, you know, like Steve, like I said, when we had 9 people on the board, we had 9 full-time table tennis people, a lot of different opinions. People always said, oh, they're always fighting. That was so overblown. It was ridiculous. And then the USOC came in and said, you guys, your governance is all screwed up. We're taking over. And ever since that day, I felt like USA table tennis died. Totally died. And I know because I was president. When I was president for 5 years, my number one problem, day in, day out, was the Olympic Committee. Every day. Calling me, problem this, problem that, elite this, someone's in trouble here, we got this. And I was like, geez, you know, how could we ever get on to things that matter for table tennis? So that's my history there. And that's why I don't like to talk about political stuff. So I got it. I edited that one out.
Well, you know, obviously there's a lot of different hats that they have to wear in Colorado Springs, and you know they certainly, you know, serving that Olympic master is an important thing for the sport too. It just may be less important for, you know, a lot of the members, the grassroots side of the sport, all of the people that you know are out just kind of keeping our clubs running. And you're right, there are 2 very different views of the sport. And, you know, I at least like to have it all tied together. I like to say, you know, that I play an Olympic sport, but what I play probably doesn't look anything like, you know, what the true Olympic version of that is. But yeah, so that's probably a pretty good place for us to stop. Got off on a little neat tangent there at the end, but you know, I don't have a lot of opportunity to pick your brain, you know, over things. So, where can people get your book? That's let's go back to that first point before we end.
They can get it at danseemiller.com, and if you want a personalized book, all you have to do is either PayPal or send me a check, or you can get it on Amazon.com.
All right, so I'll make sure that I put a link at the bottom of the article as well. And I think we're going to be live this Friday with this interview, so I'll get it out to you when it's ready to go. I really appreciate you spending a little bit of time with me here today, Dan.
All right, Steve, thanks to you, and really appreciate it. And I'm glad I was able to get my opinions out there.
All right, thanks a lot. Yeah, bye-bye.